Hello everybody, this is Dr. Vishal Trivedi from Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering, IIT Guwahati. And what we were discussing about the topics from your biology course for the class 11 and 12 under the program IIT BAL. And what we were discussing about in the chapter biotechnology in its applications. So what we have discussed so far, we have discussed about the biotechnology and its application in the field of agriculture, in the field of medicinal chemistry, in the field of medicines, in the field of diagnostics. And what we have discussed in the previous lecture is about the transgenic animals. So if you recall, we have discussed about the what is definition of transgenic animals. So transgenic animals are the animals which are carrying a foreign gene from a distant related organisms. For example, if you're talking about the rabbit, it may be carrying a gene from the human or the dog. And those are the animals are called as the transgenic animals. And then we also discuss about how you can be able to generate the transgenic animals. So we were discuss about that it has a multiple step process where in the step one, you are going to prepare a transgenic gene where the gene is going to be cloned into a transgenic cassette. And then that gene has or the cassette has to be introduced into the organism with the help of either the virus mediated transfection or with the help of the micro injections and so on. When the gene is being gone into the cell or the organism, then the when it will reaches to the nucleus, and with the help of the integration sites, it will integrate into the genome, and then it will replicate along with the animal itself. And then ultimately you have to screen the animals who got the gene integrated into the genome versus the organism or the animals where the gene is not been integrated into the animal. And that's how you are actually going to get the real transgenic animals where the gene of your interest is going to be integrated at a perfect site and it is going to express the protein of your interest. And on the other hand, along with the animals, when the animal will reproduce, it is actually going to transfer into the offsprings. So, and after that, you have to do the replication or you have to do the reproduction of these animals so that the more amount of transgenic animals can be produced, which can be able to use the so that you can be able to use these transgenic animals for the different types of applications. So after that, we have taken a couple of examples from where the transgenic animals are being produced and how and what are their characteristics. So we have discussed about the transgenic pigs, we have discussed about the transgenic cows, we have discussed about the transgenic mouse, transgenic monkeys, and so on. So in today's lecture, what we are going to discuss, we are going to discuss about the application of transgenic animals and what is the significance of the transgenic animals for the experimentation as well as for the welfare of the society. So the transgenic animals actually contribute in multiple ways for the human society. It helps to understand the disease mechanisms. It helps to understand the normal physiology, for example, how the particular type of work or particular type of mechanism is operating within the organisms. Then it also helps to produce the biological products which are very rare to produce or which are very difficult to produce under the with the help of the recombinant DNA technology. And then it also helps to test the some of the molecules, either it is for the vaccines testing trial or to the toxicity testings. So when you talk about the transgenic animals contribute in all these aspects by the two mechanism or the, by the two ways. One, where you are actually overexpressing a foreign gene into a transgenic animals, and that you are going to express the gene into a suitable vector. And then these are the organisms which actually going to help in terms of understanding the disease mechanism or understanding the normal physiology. And as well as these are the organisms which can also help you to to produce the biological products, as well as some of these molecules, when you are doing overexpression of a particular gene, the organism is acquiring a very large size, and that's how they are also very useful for the organ transplant. Apart from this overexpression scheme, you can also have a knockout scheme where you are actually going to remove a particular gene from a particular animal. For example, if we are talking about the mouse, we can actually be able to remove some of the mouse genes, and then we can actually be able to ask whether that particular gene is having a role in the disease mechanism or to the normal physiology. For example, if we knock out the thrombin or some other clotting factors, then we can also be able to see whether there will be a disturbance of the normal clotting of that particular organism or not. So in this particular knockout studies, what we are doing, we are doing the removal of the gene expressing functional gene, and that functional gene is actually giving you a functional product, and that's how you can be able to understand the role of that particular gene or the gene product into the disease mechanism as well as the normal physiology. So we'll start about the understanding the application or the significance of the transgenic animals. So we'll start with the understanding with the disease mechanisms. And if you want to understand the disease mechanism, you might have to first make a disease model. For example, if I want to understand how the blood clotting is happening, I might have to develop a model where the organism may not be able to clot the blood, or it may be something other kinds of dysfunction. So that it will be helpful to understand the different steps how the disease is happening and all that. So you have to develop the model. So in the traditional way, when the people were not having the transgenic animals, the conventional methods of developing a disease model is that you are actually looking for a naturally occurring genetic mutations. For example, you are looking for some hemophilia like mutations. So hemophilia like mutations are actually going to help you in terms of understanding the disease. But these natural occurring genetic mutations have the limitation in terms of that they are actually not going to give you any flexibility that you can actually be able to have the mutation as per your choice. You might have to rely simply on these mutations, whatever is existing within the society. And then you might also have to depend on those particular type of subjects or to the person who is having or who is carrying these mutations. So this is but basically a very, very big limitations of relying on to the natural occurring genetic mutations. Then you also have a strategy where people are injecting a particular type of chemicals. These chemicals are actually disturbing the normal physiology of that particular organism, and ultimately the organism or the animal is developing a particular disease. The classical example is that where you are actually injecting a streptozotan, and this particular drug is having a effect onto the insulin secretions, and that's how it is actually going to. So the particular animal is not able to perform the insulin mediated effects, and that's how it is actually going to develop the diabetes mellitus, which is it is actually going to develop a particular type of conditions. But these chemically induced disease models are risky because we know that this particular type of drug is interfering with the insulin metabolism. But it also could be possible that this chemically induced disease chemical may also be interfering somewhere else, and that's how whatever the effect you are seeing is probably could be a combination of multiple effects, and that's how we cannot ignore that. Apart from that, there are physical methods which actually can also cause the radiation. For example, you can have the radiations, you can have the some kind of destruction of a organ. So if you radiate a particular type of cell type or particular type of organ, it may actually doing some malfunctioning, and because of that it may develop some kind of disease. That is also very, very similar to this kind of thing, that where you are not very much sure that the radiation is not affecting the liver or other organs. For example, if I am radiating a particular breast, for example, And if I expect that because of the radiation, there will be a spontaneous mutations, and because of that, the person is going to develop the cancer. So, but what we I don't know is that if it is if that particular type of radiation is also affecting the liver or the lungs or the heart, and that might be accumulating, or that might be a cumulative effect which actually be responsible for the development of the breast cancers. Apart from that, sometimes what people are doing is also they are actually removing the particular type of organ, and that's how the people have initially actually developed the diabetes model. For example, when they are actually removing the pancreas from a dog, and that's how the people, the scientists have discovered the diabetes, that they have actually removed the pancreas from the dog, and what they have found is that the pancreas, if they remove of the pancreas from the dog is actually developing a disease which is actually caused the diabetes, because when these dogs are actually urinating, that urine is attracting the lot of ants, and these urine contains very high amount of sugar. So that's how they have actually discovered that it is actually the pancreas which is responsible for reducing the blood sugar level. And that's how when they have prepared an extract of pancreas, and then that's how eventually they have actually isolated the insulin from the pancreas, and that's how they have discovered that the insulin is the driving factor for this particular diabetes condition. But that was the era when there was no genetic engineering available, there was no technology available, so that you can be able to deliver the particular type of the gene and all that. So because of that, they were having no option but to go for this kind of approach. But you can imagine that the pancreas is not only secreting the insulin, pancreas is also secreting some other biologically relevant products, and that could be the reason that it may be actually affecting the many multiple things, and that could be also responsible for a particular type of conditions. So because of these, the conventional methods are easy to perform, because they does not require a very extensive genetic molecular biology tools, and that does not require a lot of training also. For example, if I want to develop the diabetes, I can just simply take this drug and inject it, and that's actually is going eventually the animal is going to develop the diabetes mellitus. Or for example, if I just expose the animal to the radiation or to the obstruction or to removal of organ, all these conventional methods were easy to perform, but they were having the one or other kinds of problems. For example, I have listed some of the limitations. For example, there was no precise control. Like when you go for this chemically induced disease conditions, you don't have any control over the action of this particular chemical. Like it could affect the insulin metabolism, but it also could affect some other kinds of metabolism in some other organ, and that could also be a contributory factors. Then it is also affecting a gross physiology. For example, it is not only affecting the pancreas, it may also affecting the liver, it may be affecting the heart, and it may be affecting some other thing. And that is what I have said in the third point, is that it is actually going to contribute to the multiple organs, because you don't have any control over your action, because it is not very precise. And that's how the people have shifted towards the transgenic animals to develop a disease model, because with the transgenic animals, you will have the full information that this particular gene might be responsible or may be responsible. So that's how you can actually overexpress that particular gene, or you can actually knock out that particular gene and to develop a particular type of disease model. And then once you develop the disease model, you can understand the the mechanisms of the some of the other processes, or you can be able to use that model for screening the compounds or some other kinds of applications. So let's discuss some of the disease model which are being developed utilizing the transgenic animals. So the first understanding the disease mechanism, the transgenic animals or the transgenic approach is actually helping in multiple ways. For example, it is genetically altered animals either by overexpression or to the knockout, and they resemble the signature pattern of a particular immune disease condition. For example, you can have a particular type of conventional approach where you can just remove the organ or you can inject a chemical, but you may not be able to develop a particular signature pattern of a human disease, because human metabolism may be very different from animal metabolism. And that's how acquiring or achieving a particular perfect signature pattern of human disease is a very, very difficult and challenging task. And that can be achieved by the help of the transgenic animal, because you can overexpress a particular gene or you can knock out a particular gene, and that would be very, very precise. You are actually simply removing a one block actually, whereas in other cases you might be affecting multiple blocks, and that one block, you know that you are affecting one organ, but you may not be aware of the other blocks. That's why the transgenic approach is very, very precise. The other advantage is that it is actually going to affect only the target specific genes. Then for doing this kind of study, you don't require a human subject, because if you want to go with the genetically altered species or genetically mutations, you always have to go with the human species, and then you always have to remember that the human subjects, although two people are having diabetes, but their social setup or their social background may not be identical. For example, one person might be having the diabetes, but he may also have the hypertension, he may also have the kidney related disease. So you are actually simply focusing on the diabetes and the mutations related to diabetes, but all these additional factors might be contributing. And that's all. On the other hand, utilizing a human subject are requiring a lot of approvals and lot of consents are required, and that is very difficult to perform. And on the other hand, with the human subject, you always have a limitation that you cannot perform any kind of study you like to, because with the animals you can actually to sacrifice them, you can actually recover their organs, you can do histopathology and all other kinds of things you can do. With the human subjects, you can do a very, very limited study, because you cannot sacrifice a human only for understanding a disease mechanism and so on. It is cheap, because transgenic animals, once you produce the particular type of transgenic animals, then it is going to be cheap and quick, because you can have as many transgenic animals possible. Then it is actually going to be reproducible, because transgenic animals are going to have a minimal variation from the one animal to another animal, whereas in the case of humans, it is actually going to have a very, very different, because one human which is also diabetic or hypertension is very, very different from the other human, because of its local environment, because of the human psychology and all other kinds of factors which are contributing into the physiology of a human subject. So for example, we have different types of model. We have AIDS mouse model, we have the Alzheimer mouse model, we have the onco mouse model, we have diabetes model, we have zebrafish based cardiovascular diseases model and all that. So let's discuss about some of these models and understand how the transgenic animals are contributing into the understanding the disease mechanism. So the first model what we are discussing is the acquired immunodeficiency, or the AIDS model. You know that the AIDS is not being done, or AIDS does not develop in any animal, because of the particular type of physiological effects or other kinds of effects. Only the monkey are the only animal where you can have the AIDS, but it is being caused by the simian immunodeficiency viruses, whereas AIDS is caused by HIV, like human immunodeficiency viruses. And HIV is very much close to what is SIV, but with the monkey, the only issue is that if you want to utilize the monkey, the approach is going to be very costly, and then it is actually also not very, very friendly, because monkey is a very difficult animal to handle, and monkeys are very difficult to get approval also. So that's how the people have developed some of the AIDS model. So that what they have done is they have actually made the mouse model.
which is called as SCID model. So in the SCID model, they have made the mouse which is immunocompromised. And because of that, this particular mouse can actually now start allowing the HIV or the AIDS virus to replicate. And that's how these mice are now developing the AIDS-like disease. The other animals which can also be used for the AIDS model are the rats, the cat, the rabbit, and the Drosophila. The advantage of the AIDS model is that it is cheap. It is it's because it is cheap, and also since you know most the function of most of the genes what is present in these animals, you can be able to understand the contribution of the additional factors what you are going to put it into these transgenic mouse models, and you can also understand if there will be any change happening. So apart from that, you also have the Alzheimer mouse. So Alzheimer is a disease which is a neurodegenerative disease where you have the amyloid plaques. So what is Alzheimer disease? Alzheimer is a progressive disease which causes the progressive brain damage, causing problem with the memory, thinking, and behavior. So Alzheimer is a disease which is mostly happening into the old people, where they are actually losing the in their brain and their ability to memorize and do some kind of behavior. So you can imagine that this is a typical Alzheimer patients where you have the this is actually the size of a normal brain, but in the Alzheimer disease, because of these plaque formations, the brain is actually shrinking. And you know that the brain, when the brain is shrinking, it is actually reducing, or it is actually, the neurons are actually dying. And because of that, the person is losing its memory, the person is losing its behavior, as, you know, some of the things what he could be able to do in his young age, could not be able to do, and he's also losing its thinking power. So why it is happening? Because the protein build up in the brain to form the structure which is called as the plaques and tangles. So these plaques are actually the protein aggregates, and they also actually cross link the multiple type of neurons. So because of that, the flexibility and the fluidity within the brain is actually reducing, and apart from that, the brain is also shrinking because of that, it is actually losing the amount of volume or amount of area what is available for recording the different types of activities. You know that the brain is simply just like a CD disc, right? So if you have a 10 mm CD disc, you will have more volume, more area to write. Whereas if you have 8 mm CD, you actually are going to have the less space for doing the some functions. And what you are going to record into the CD, you are actually recording the different types of data, right? So in this particular type of thing, in a particular type of CD, what you have is you are actually collecting the data, right? So if you are having a lesser diameter or lesser, like for example, if you have 10 mm of CD, you are going to have the larger volume. If you have 8 mm CD, you are going to have lesser data. And that is what exactly happening when you have Alzheimer disease, because you are losing the memory, you are losing the ability to think, and you are actually not being able to do the behavior what you were doing before. And it is happening because there will be a loss of connection between the nerve cells, and eventually causing the death of the nerve cell and loss of the brain tissue. So why it is happening? It is happening because the fragments of beta amyloid precursor protein, which is also called APP, is actually aggregating within the brain. So these precursor proteins are being generated, and then they are actually forming the amyloid peptides, and these amyloid peptides are sticking to each other, and that's how they are developing the aggregates. So APP mutations are induced peptide aggregation, and that is the key to develop the AD mouse model. So TG2576 is one of the classical Alzheimer model which has been developed in order to produce the genuine human amyloid. And that is the so in the so and what is happening in this particular transgenic mouse model, the APP mutation is being incorporated, and because of that, the APP this mutations, the mouse is suffering with the similar kind of pathophysiology what is being found into the human, which means it is forming the plaques, it is forming, it is the you know, exhibiting the change in the memory, thinking and behavior, and with all that can be mapped into this particular transgenic mouse model, and that is very, very comparable to the human behavior. Now let's go on to the next model, and next model is the cancer mouse model. So cancer mouse model is a very, very popular way of developing the you know, so the cancer mouse model in the mouse is very popular because the mouse is very easy to handle. So to study the cancer formation and to screen the tumor drugs, so this is the main purpose, right? To study the cancer formation, how, what are the different mechanisms are happening, what are different processes are happening, and so on. So this is a one model where you have a nude mice. You see this mice does not have any hairs on their skin, and that's how this mice is called as the nude mice. And nude mice are immunocompromised because they don't have the very, very well-developed thymus. So because of that, they don't have the well-developed T cells, and because of that, these mice are immunocompromised, and they can actually allow the growth as well as the replication, the proliferation of the exogenously injected cancer cells. So this is a typical traditional way of developing the cancer. So what you do is you take the nude mice, you inject the cancer cells of the human origin, and that cancer cell are going to grow into these mice, and that's how they are actually going to give you the cancer. So oncogenes are either mutated to induce spontaneous cancer formations. So there are two ways in which you can actually develop or get the mouse model to you know, for the cancer mouse model. Either you actually overexpress the oncogenes, and that actually is going to cause the spontaneous cancer formation, or you can actually have a knockout of tumor suppressor gene. So once you have the knockout of tumor suppressor gene, it is actually going to allow the tumor to be formed into these cells, into these organisms. One of the classical example is that where you are actually overexpressing the HER2, and if you overexpress the HER2, it is actually associated with the cancer formation. For example, you have a HER2 transgenic mice, which is, the name is FVB/NMMT new mice, and that is actually a HER2 transgenic mice, and that actually is developing the tumor. So there are more than 13 different types of transgenic mouses are available, which are being used in the you know, in the study of the cancer formation or to the screen of anti-tumor drugs. When you want to screen the anti-tumor drug, what you are going to do is you take the mouse, and suppose these are the two transgenic mouse which are, and then what you do is you induce the cancer formation. So for example, in this case, you see here the mice has developed a tumor, and this is the mice which is untreated, like where you have not treated that with the anti-cancer drug, whereas this is the mice which is being treated with the anti-cancer drug from the green tea, right? And you see that the cancer is now not present in this particular mice. So what you do is you take the vernier calipers and screw gauge, and you can measure the volume of this particular cancer, and that also you can do here as well. And that's how you will be able to know whether the anti-cancer compound, what is present in this particular formulation, is working or not. Then you have the transgenic models for diabetes. So these are the transgenic model for diabetes is good for studying the gene and their role in peripheral insulin functions. It is also good for a model of insulin secretions. So you have the glucokinase and beta receptor knockout mice, or uncoupling protein UCP knockout mice, and that is actually going to give you the acute as well as the chronic model for anti-diabetic agents. So to screen the anti-diabetic agents, and so these are if you now have these kind of knockout mice, they will actually going to develop the diabetes at a particular stage of their life cycle, and then you can be able to screen the anti-diabetic agents. Then I think you remember when we were talking about the zebrafish, the transgenic zebrafish, we discussed that there are multiple ways in which the zebrafish actually can contribute to develop the cardiovascular disease models. So what happens is that when you are doing a population study for a particular human population, what you will see is that the particular type of mutations or the single nucleotide polymorphism is associated with the cardiovascular diseases. So what you do is you take all these mutations, you incorporate those mutations into a typical zebrafish, and that's how you develop the transgenic zebrafish. And the advantage of developing the transgenic zebrafish is that you can be able to visualize whatever is functionality is happening within this. The heart functions, the vascular systems, and all other kind of things are very much close to what is happening in the humans. So once you establish with the experimental model of these candidate drugs, candidate molecules, you can actually go back to the humans and try to implement those, and that's how you can be able to understand the mechanism, and you can also be able to, once you understand the mechanism, you can be able to come up with the therapeutic strategies and therapeutic molecules. So these are the different types of models where the zebrafish is being used. For example, you can have the atrial fibrillations, you can have the syndromes, you have atrial dilations, you have cardiomyopathy. So all these, you see, these are the genes which are being used for developing the different types of disease models, and that's how the people have, so these are the, you know, different types of references where the people have reported the results related to this particular type of results. For example, you can have the model where you can study the heart rate variability, because that is one of the serious concerns. And these are the particular type of genes which are associated with the heart rate variability, and then you can study them in the different types of the zebrafish genotype, and that's how you will understand the role of these genes. So this is all about the role of the transgenic animals into the developing the particular different types of disease models. This is not an exhaustive discussion about the transgenic animals and their role in the developing the different types of disease models or to understand the physiological aspects. There are multiple and enormous models are available, and which I have not covered. Like, for example, there are models for atherosclerosis, there are models for the different types of disease model also, like malaria, TB, and all that kind of things. And there are models for the some of the clotting diseases, like anemia and all that kind of things, and diabetes also. Anyway, we have discussed. So these models are very extensive, and there's an exhaustive list. So that all we have not discussed. So let's move on to the next topic. And the next topic is that the transgenic animals are also very good in terms of providing the biological products. So transgenic animals, and I think if you remember when we were discussing about the transgenic pigs and transgenic cows and transgenic rabbit, we discussed that how they were actually being used to produce the different types of biological products. So transgenic animals are being used to produce, genetically engineered to produce human pharmaceuticals like recombinant protein in their saliva, milk, urine, or the blood, and that thing is called as the farming. So transgenic animals also produce the recombinant proteins, like in the milk you actually produce the human antithrombin, or the chicken egg white you can develop the monoclonal antibodies or human interferon gamma or HAS. Similarly, the insulin you can produce for diabetes mellitus, or you can have the ATD for ATT deficiency. Then some cases you also can have the vaccines which are being overexpressed or produced within the transgenic animals. You can have the growth hormones for the some of the deficiencies which are related to some of the problems, or you can have the coagulation factors like factor 8 and factor 9. And then you have the lactoferrin, which is good for the animal feed. So some cases people are developing the lactoferrin into the cow's milk, and that's how the cow milk is good for, or lactoalbumin, so that the cow milk is good for the infant formula preparation, and as well as the infants are good in terms of the digesting these foods. Apart from that, the transgenic animals are also being used for the organ transplants, like the transgenic animals that are genetically modified to have the organ that can be transplanted into the human. Why it is so? Because some of these transgenic animals do not express the foreign antigens. So you know that when you want to go for the transplantations, you have to go with the MSC typing and MSC matching, and the MSC matching is happening because MSC is recognizing the antigens, and that's how there is a ultimate requirement that the MHC of the two individuals should match so that they should not cross react. But that could be avoided if you don't have, if the particular type of organ does not express the foreign antigens. Promising alternatives. So if you have a transgenic animals which can actually be able to donate the organ, then you are not going to be dependent on to the human donors, because getting a human donor is a very, very difficult task. And so far, the pig is the only animal which is being used very extensively and which has been having a promising alternatives to the human donors. Already people have successfully transplanted the pig's heart wall and into the humans. Apart from that, the liver, lungs, kidney are also being tested. Why it is so? Because the pig's physiology is closely matches that of the humans, and it is much less expensive than the monkeys and the other primates. Because first of all, the monkey and the other primates like the baboons or the gibbons or like the orangutans and all those kinds of bigger primates are very difficult to get. And on the other hand, there are so many regulations to utilize these primates for the human organ transplant. And that's how people are going with the transgenic animal, because one of the advantage with the transgenic animal is because they are being produced in a laboratory conditions. They are not being present in the nature. So that's how there is a less pressure onto these animals for, or there's less ethical issues compared to if you are using with the monkey or other primates, because then always there is a issue of the conservations. There will be always issue of that they may be get extinct and all that. So that's how there is very strong restrictions on utilizing these animals for the organ transplant. Apart from that, you can also have the super pig. The super pig is good for the producing the human hormones, as well as it is good for the meat purposes. So these super pigs are fast growing, and they are actually very good in terms of fast growing, as well as they eat less. So they express the growth hormones, and as well as they express the they are good for the meat purposes. Then you also have the super fish. We have discussed about the salmon. So it is genetically modified Atlantic salmon, and that is very good also. Because it has the growth hormone, and that can be used also. Then you have the smart mouse. So if you want to understand how the intelligence works, you can also have the transgenic model, and that transgenic model is called as the smart mouse because it has a superior learning as well as the memory power. And the one of the mouse model which is doing all this is called as the doggy mouse, and that doggy mouse is modified to overexpress the NR2B transgenes in the cortex and the hippocampus, thalamus, and the brainstem, as well as the cerebellum. So this particular type of transgene, once it has been expressed in all the different parts of the brain, it actually provides the mouse for the superior learning as well as the memory power. And because of that, once the mouse is doing all this, you can be able to understand how the different parts of the brains are contributing in terms of the learning experience as well as the memory of the particular organisms or particular type of animals. And that's how you can be able to study these events, and as well as you can be able to use this particular mouse model to screen the compounds or to screen the therapies which actually can improve the learning experiences as well as the memory of the animals. So this is all about the transgenic animals and how the transgenic animals is contributing in terms of the different aspects, whether it is related to the understanding the different types of disease models or the physiology, or whether the transgenic animals are providing the source for the different types of animal products or the therapeutic molecules. And apart from that, there is always been good about the transgenic animals, because they are having so many advantages, but they are also having the disadvantages. So let's discuss about the advantage as well as the disadvantage of the transgenic animals. We have discussed a lot about the advantages, like it can allow you to express the gene which is for the certain metabolism and for the production of the protein. An animal used for the transgenic purposes naturally carry the mechanism need to produce the complete protein. These mechanisms are absent in the cell culture like conditions. See, expression through the cell culture or bacterial culture required constant monitoring as well as the sampling. For example, if you want to express some protein into the bacteria or the cell culture, you might have to monitor the growth of that particular culture, and you might also have to induce the protein production all that. Whereas that all is not required, because you are doing in transgenic animals and animal has the machinery to do all that on its own. The isolation and purification of expert protein in conventional method is more difficult than purifying a protein from the animal milk or the body fluid, because once it express a particular protein into the milk or the body fluid, it is more or less very pure, because it is not a very very complex mixture. Because when it is present, for example, if an animal is producing something in saliva, the saliva does not contain a lot of protein. Saliva only contains lysozymes and some other antimicrobial peptides. So that's how if your protein of interest is present, it is actually going to give you easy to purify. It is more cost effective as the product is efficiently passed through milk with an average yield of 53% with a 99% purity. So because the purification is easy, it is actually going to be very very cheap, and it is actually also going to give you the high yield. It has been estimated that the transgenic animal produce in its lifetime the 100 to 200 million mLs of the pharmaceuticals, which means that amount of insulin and all other kinds of drugs what has been produced from a single animal is somewhere around $100 to $200 million, which is a very very high amount, because of the life of these animals are very big compared to the life of the in vitro cell culture species. What are the disadvantages? Disadvantage is that the transgenic project is very 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 expensive, because producing a protein from a cell culture or the bacterial culture is very very cheap compared to that. First you have to actually develop the transgenic animals with that particular type expressing that particular foreign gene, and that itself is a very expensive process. Generation of transgenic animals are also very expensive because of the long gestation periods, litter size, and the higher maintenance cost of the recipient animal. So there is a cost factor which is associated with the transgenic animal project, and that is very very high compared to the cell culture as well as the bacterial system. There are a very high mortality rate and other deleterious effect on animal used by the researcher to create these transgenic breeds. It has been observed that the transgenic pigs having enhanced growth rate and efficient feed conversion exhibit reduced reproductive performance and may suffer from the arthritis as well as the dermatitis. Because the transgenic animals are always being channelized to produce a particular type of protein or the gene, it always have a deficiency in terms of to perform the reproduction, as well as they are sometimes suffering from the different types of disease. For example, in this case, like the pig is being suffered from the arthritis as well as the dermatitis. The large number of recipient is required for the embryo transfer because of the low transgenic rates. So because you have the low embryo transfer, it requires large number of recipient, which means you might have to put lot of embryos into the recipient, and then only you will get very small amount of recovery. Transgenic food has been produced and offer better productivity in terms of both yield and quantity. However, there are some apprehension about the safety of the transgenic food, because something what you are developing in the transgenic food animals are actually being considered as unnatural, because it is not being present in that particular animal in a natural condition. For example, if I am producing the lactoalbumin or lactoferrin in a mouse, in a cow, the cow does not produce these proteins. Or suppose I am producing XYZ protein in the pig or mouse or something, mouse is not supposed to produce that particular protein. And that's how when people are consuming that protein from that particular source, they always have some kind of appreciations about the safety of that particular product, because it could be possible that the product may not be of that product what is being naturally be present. So this is all about the different types of transgenic transgenic animals and their usage in the different types of products, or developing the different types of products. And I have given you a comparative state analysis of what is their advantages as well as the disadvantages. There are so many ethical issues which are also being associated with the transgenic animals, because when you are producing these animals, you cannot sacrifice as per your wish, because these are the animal at the end. So these are the different aspects what we have covered in the transgenic animals. And with this, I would like to conclude our lecture here. Thank you.